A2PC. Today we've got section 10.4. 10.4, good buddy, this is our last installment of our analytic geometry work here in this class. I think you found that with chapters 9 and 10, we really got a nice look at some algebra skills from earlier in the year. It really is a clever design of our textbook to incorporate this at the end of the year, where we can come back and revisit things like logarithmic and trigonometric functions again in a new context, as well as some of our geometry work from freshman year. It just kind of tie everything together. It's a really, really neat way to introduce new ideas while still reviewing some old ones. So it's really like the perfect placement for a chapter like this. And I certainly hope that you've enjoyed chapters 9 and 10 as we've looked at this analytic geometry content. So let's wrap things up with looking at lines and planes in space. To introduce this, first of all, a line L in it traveling through 3 space can be expressed two ways. The first way is using parametric equations. And what we need to construct this line is we need to have some point that we know the line contains, and we need to have some vector that describes really how the points are changing in the different directions. Since we have an x and a y and a z component now, this is really kind of acting like our slope. It's telling what the change is in x, what the change is in y, and what the change is in the z directions based on those components. So this is kind of like our rate of change. And then this is like our what we would think of as our y-intercept, going back to algebra 1. This is our known initial starting point. And so the parametric equations are actually pretty self-explanatory. You see, they all kind of look like y equals mx plus b, except now our x values are going to be found by starting at our known x value and then adding some change contributed in the x direction by the vector as time goes by. So each little increment of time is going to tack on movement of a units in that direction, and we're going to add that onto the known value that we start with. And the same will be true for y, using the y component of the vector and the initial y value as time goes by. And similarly with z, it does the same thing. Now, if we take these and we isolate the parameter, we solve them all for t, then we're able to set them equal to each other as quantities of x and y. And you can see it kind of looks like almost like the equation of an ellipse or a conic section from chapter 9. But really, it's just saying that the ratio of our change in x value minus its initial point over what's given by the vector, that's the same ratio as what's happening with y and what's happening with z. And this is called the symmetric equation. It allows us to have the equation of a line given symmetrically. All right. Now, for a plane in space, we need to have some different information. You probably learned in geometry class that if you have 3 non-collinear points, those 3 points in space will define a plane. And that is definitely true. And now we get to actually see the algebra behind that to kind of confirm what we kind of know visually from geometry class. So the information that's needed is a normal vector, or a vector that is on a perpendicular path with an entire plane. Okay, and so normal means perpendicular. That statement, I don't know why I put that down there, but that's what normal means. And really, this is a physics term. It's used very commonly. We're talking about normal forces acting perpendicular to maybe an object's path of travel. And so perpendicular relationships are very useful in the physics field as well. But anyway, this normal vector kind of sets a direction that we know everything in our plane is going to have a perpendicular relationship or an orthogonal relationship with that normal vector. And then we have some point that we know on the plane. So we use those normal vector components A, B, and C, and then we attach to those the quantity of the variable x minus our known x value. And what that does is those products then sum up to 0 to give us the standard form of the equation of the plane. And then if we actually do the little algebra simplifying steps of distributing and combining like terms, we end up with the general form of the equation of a plane. And if you look closely, or you may remember seeing this when we did 3 variable systems in chapter 7, where we had 3 equations and 3 unknowns. We were often solving for x, y, and z. We were seeing equations of planes that were already in this format. All right, so let's get right into the examples here. Our first example, find the parametric and symmetric equations of line L that passes through this point. So here's our known x, our known y, and our known z coordinates. And then we also have the rate of change of x, the rate of change of y, and the rate of change of z. All right, so for the parametric equations, let's start with those. My equation for x is going to take my known x value of 3, and it's going to add to that the change given by the x component of v as time goes by. That one's done. It's that easy. My equation for y is going to take my known y value, and it's going to add on my change in the y direction given by the vector v, and that happens as time goes by. And we repeatedly, you know, as our increments of time increase, then the y value is going to keep dropping 7 every unit of time that goes by. Okay, and then last of our parametric equations, z is going to take our known z value from the point, z1, okay, and it's going to add on a change of negative 10 every increment of time that goes by. All right, so our symmetric equations, we're just going to take each of these and set them, solve them for t. So to do that with x, I would subtract the 3 and then divide everything by 3. Okay, so now that is solved for t. That's going to be equal to the same increment of time going by for y. So let's solve this parametric equation for y, solve that for t. We'd take our y value, we'd add over the 5 and divide everything by negative 7. Same thing for z. If we were going to solve that parametric equation for t, we would add, subtract over the 1, and divide by negative 10. There we go. All right, now what makes this more difficult is that, often we will be given information that's not necessarily in that wonderful little component form of a vector and the point that we have. So for number 12, here's an example of one that's a little bit different. So here we've got a parallel line given, and remember, we just want to extrapolate from this parallel line what is the vector v in component form that's going to tell us the change of x, the change of y, and the change of z. Because we already have a known x and y and z value to work with. So let's see what we can piece together here. I'm going to make a little place here for our parametric equations, and we'll start there. We'll do symmetrics underneath. That operation is not going to be very tricky, as we saw in the last example. So this parallel line that they've given us, these are parametric equations, and just realize that right here, that change for our x equation, that plus 3t, that is telling me that the x component is 3. This change in the y component is telling me that the vector v, its y component is negative 2. And this is a plus 1t, so c, or the z component of our vector v, is a 1 happening every single time that an increment of time goes by. So now that we're able to pull that key information out of the line that we're given, and we have our known point, we can set up our parametric equations. X equals 7 plus 3t, y equals negative 8 minus 2t, and z equals 2 plus 1t. The symmetric equations would then be x minus 7 all over 3 is equal to y plus 8 all over negative 2, which is equal to z minus 2 all over 1. I made that 2 look an awful lot like another z, didn't I? That's why we put notches on our z's, people. All right, so that does it here. Again, just kind of showing some of the differences that may go into how you get the change based on those vector components, how you grab that out of maybe different information that's provided to you. Next, we learned in geometry class that if I have two distinct points that are somewhere in space, then there is one unique line that passes through them. And you saw that in planar geometry, and you saw that in your Algebra 1 class as well. But it actually works in 3 space also. So I could take either of these two points as my given starting point. It really does not matter because our line will end up containing both. So I've got x1, I've got y1, and I've got z1. I'm just going to use 2, 3, negative 1 as my initial point. And then my vector v is just going to take the these two points and construct a vector out of them. And it's really just taking the change in x, the change in y, the change in z. That's what component form is. So if I end up at 1 and I start up at 2, that's a change of negative 1 in the x direction. From 3 to negative 5, I went down 8. And then from negative 1 to 3, I had to go up 4. So that's a positive 4. And there we can see our a, b, and c values. Again, just coming from information that's provided in a different way, we're still able to come up with the information we need to construct these equations. So x equals 2 minus 1t, y equals 3 minus 8t, and z equals negative 1 plus 4t. Now, these parametric equations may look very, very different if you had chosen the 1, negative 5, 3 as your starting point. But realize if you started plugging in t values, you begin to see the same points emerge. So even though they are different ways of expressing the same line, and they look different, they are still producing the same line and are therefore both correct. It's kind of like when you would write the equation of a line in point slope form, you know, back in algebra 1. Depending on what point you choose to start with, you may have an equation that looks very different, but when you clean up everything or start evaluating points, you'll notice that you're talking about the same line even though your equations look different. Symmetric here, x minus 2 all over negative 1. I'll call that negative x plus 2 then. All right, and then, I meant to say that this is equal to, because symmetric, they're all equal to each other. We have a y minus 3 all over negative 8, which is equal to a z plus 1 all over 4. So it seems complicated, but really when you start looking at the math that we're doing, it really is simple linear, like take a point and evaluate a rate of change to that point. All right, now the second half of this lesson, now we're gonna look at planes. And so remember to make this work, we need to have a known point, and we've got that right here. And then we need to have a normal vector. So when they say perpendicular to this vector, they're indicating that this plane has this vector running perpendicular to that entire plane. It's the normal vector. And normal vectors are commonly called vector n. So I prefer component form, just because it shows me the numbers that I need to see and those gets those extra variables out of the way. So here we have it. Okay, so we're going to take 2 times x minus 1 plus negative 1 times y minus 0 plus 1 times z minus negative 3 equal to 0. There's the general form of our plane, and we'd probably clean that up a little bit. Call it 2 times the quantity x minus 1 minus y plus quantity z plus 3. I know that quantity is kind of redundant there, but the idea is to see x and y groupings, leave the coefficients out there, and have it set equal to 0 to have it in general form. This isn't general form. This is standard form. Okay, to produce general form, here's where we would just distribute and combine the like terms, and really we only have one distribution to do. So we got 2x minus 2 minus y plus z plus 3 equals 0. That's a 2x, a minus y, a plus z, and then plus 1 equals 0. There's our general form. Okay, and that is very, very light on the workload, especially once we know the kind of the process to make this thing work, because we were given exactly what we needed, right? We were given the normal vector, and we were given a point that our plane contains. Our final example, this is the ultimate geometry move here. We now have the general form of a plane that passes through three points. Algebraically, how can I find that equation? I know that three non-collinear points determine a plane. Now let's make that happen. I'm going to refer to these points as P, Q, and R. And so I don't know what the normal vector is. So I need to construct two vectors out of these 3 points. So I'm going to make vector PQ, and I'm going to make vector QR. All right, so to go from P to Q, I went from 4 to 2 in the X. That means I went down 2. I went from negative 1 up to 5 in the Y component. That means I went up 6. And I went from 3 to 1 in the Z component. That means I went down 2. There's vector PQ. And remember, this means the same thing as negative 2i plus 6j minus 2k. Vector QR, now to go from Q to R, I went from 2 to negative 1. That means I went down 3 in the X. In the Y, I went from 5 to 2. I went also down 3 there. And then I went from 1 to 1 in the Z. There was no change there. So that means I've got negative 3i, plus a negative minus 3j, and I've got 0k. All right, so now to find these, again, let's call this first one u and this one v. If I were to find the cross product of those, that will produce the normal vector. And that's what I want. I could take any of these 3 points and use them, but I need that normal vector to make this work. So u cross v is going to be the determinant of I, j, k, and then we've got negative 2, 6, negative 2, and then we've got negative 3, negative 3, 0. And if I go across the top row, I would have I times 6 times 0 minus negative 3 times negative 2 minus j times negative 2 times 0 minus 3 times negative 3 times negative 2 plus k times 6 minus a negative 18. So that's negative 6i plus 6j plus 24k. All right, so this is our normal vector, negative 6, 6, 24. And you could scale that down if you wanted easier numbers to work with. It doesn't really make that much of a difference. But obviously, if these were unruly numbers, realize that we're really just after something that's perpendicular. It doesn't matter what the magnitude of it is, as long as it runs perpendicular. So if I divide all these components by 6, as I could here, I could be working with negative 1, 1, 4, and it would work just as well. We'd end up with the same result. And maybe we'll go through both of those just to confirm that in this example. I certainly hope they work out. All right, so if we take a point, and it looks to me like R is probably going to be the easiest to work with numerically. And remember, I could choose any of these to act as my x1, y1, and z1. Then the standard form is going to take this component form here, and it's going to, we'll start with the red one since I've got the red marker out. So we will have negative 6 from the vector times the quantity x minus negative 1. Again, grabbing that x value from the point that I've chosen. Then we have plus 6, now I'm looking at the y component, times the quantity y minus 2. Again, that 2 coming from the point that I've chosen, that's its y coordinate. And then plus 24 times z minus the z coordinate of my point, equaling 0. If we distribute, we end up with a negative 6x, a positive 6y, and a positive 24z. 6 and 12 is 18 negative, and then 18, 24 is minus 42. Equals 0. And again, since this is an equation, we are able to scale everything down, divide both sides of this equation by 6 or even negative 6 if we wanted to tidy it up even more, and we would still have an equivalent expression here. So this right here is an acceptable solution, but we would be able to simplify it by dividing both sides by 6 and have negative x plus y plus 4z minus 7 equals 0. There's our simplified general form. And let's just see, if I had started with this negative 1 the whole time, negative 1 times x plus 1 plus 6 times, oh, not 6, 1 times y minus 2, plus 4 times z minus 1, that's a 4, not a y, equal to 0. If I distribute, negative x minus 1 plus y minus 2 plus 4z minus 4 equals 0. Here you can see all of our x, y, and z terms are the same. And our if we combine the constants together, we do get a negative 7. So that kind of confirms that scaling it down here or at the very end of your problem produces a similar result. Again, it's just fascinating to me, this topic of analytic geometry. When I was a student in high school, analytic geometry was its own course. So you take trigonometry as its own course and then analytic geometry as its own course. And this stuff just blew me away because we started pulling things from my, you know, middle school math classes and the geometry that I'd taken thus far and fusing that with some of the algebra 2 and trigonometry work that we were doing. It was just at a juncture like this that all the math started coming together. And I hope we're feeling that same type of appreciation for all that we've learned thus far. And that's ultimately just a massive stockpile on our part before we take on calculus. Here's a look at your assignment for section 10.4.